something that's a war. God will bless your home. I'll bring you more than a song, for a song in itself is not what search much deeper within, through the way things appear, you're looking into my heart. I'm coming thank you.
Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for granting us this new day. For each day is another opportunity for us to go deeper in our relationship with you and to share Christ with others. So help us to be the light of Christ wherever we may have influence, that Christ may be glorified in us and through us. We confess we are weak and needy, but we rejoice in the fact that when we are weak, you are strong. And while we pray for the quick end to this pandemic, help us not to lose this opportunity to depend on you and to show others that indeed you are more than enough for all our needs. Your grace is sufficient. So Lord, be more than enough in all of our lives, whether we are battling physical illnesses, financial setbacks, or broken relationships. We pray for your healing and for your restoration. We pray that we would experience your power and provision in our lives as your sons and daughters, and that our lives would be a testament to your power and glory. But Lord, even if you choose not to heal and restore at this time, help our lives to be a testament to your power and glory still. For you are good and trustworthy. We also want to thank you for our pastors and church leaders. We ask for extra measure of your grace and blessings for them as they serve you in your church. Equip them for every good work you have called them to. Be also with those we partner with in Christ. Be with Missionary Lee in Korea, Pastor Che in Guatemala, Pastor Young in Redwood City, Pastor Peter in San Jose, and those at the Heritage Home. We pray for their ministries to bear much fruit, that you would provide and protect them. We pray over our nation and the upcoming election this Tuesday. Their predictions of unrest after the election, we pray for cooler heads to prevail. And no matter the outcome, that the democratic process will be peacefully accepted by the American people. We pray for the leaders of this nation to do the right thing, lead by example, and show unity. We also pray for our church as we prepare to move to another location. Direct and lead the committee members as they seek to find the right location. Grant them wisdom and discernment, and grant all of us unity as we seek to know your will. And be now with Pastor Joseph as he teaches from your word. May our worship and every word spoken be a pleasing offering to you. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Not just on Sunday morning, but every day.
I have a couple of announcements. Wanted to recognize our Fall Festival volunteers. You guys did an awesome job, and I saw the kids just staying at church for, they wouldn't go home. Got a lot of candy, and they had a blast, right? Let's just give it up for our volunteers. That's for a great job. We made this happen. Thank you, everybody, and for your participation as well. I want to remind you that Thanksgiving Sunday is the 22nd. It's the fourth Sunday of this November, this month. Thanksgiving, we want to have the communion service. It's the fourth Sunday of the week, of the month. And put some instruction on the bulletin for us. If you'd like to participate from home, you can pick up the communion kit from church a week ahead, or prepare your own. Both ways, it's fine. If you'd rather have it at church, please, church is here. We're not going anywhere yet. Feel free to join in our safe on-site worship together as church. I believe that's it. Yes. We have one member who will be baptized next Sunday at their home. So it's Mr. Cho, Kitchen Cho. He lives in Livermore, and we look forward to that. So if you'd like to join and watch on Zoom, I can share the link with you for you to celebrate with him and the family of this wonderful thing that God has done in his life. So let me know if you'd like to watch. Let's open the Word of God this morning together to the book of Acts. Another exciting story from God's Word. Today's message is from the book of Acts, chapter 15. In fact, it's about the whole, it's from the whole chapter, but we'll be only reading from verses 12 to 21. And I want to just invite you to read responsively. The words are not on the screen. Are the words on the screen, Pastor Jim? Oh, they are. Okay. Let's just read it from the screen of the Bible, preferably. And we'll read one verse at a time. I'll read first, and you can responsibly read after me. Verse 12 of chapter 15, book of Acts. And all the assembly fell silent, and they listened to Barnabas and Paul as they related what signs and wonders God had done through them among the Gentiles. After they finished speaking, James replied, "Brothers, listen to me. Simon has related how God first visited the Gentiles to take from them a people for his name. And with this, the words of the prophets agree, just as it is written, 'After this, I will return. I will rebuild the tent of David that has fallen. I will rebuild its ruins, and I will restore it, that the remnant of mankind may seek the Lord, and all the Gentiles who are called by my name, says the Lord, and who makes these things known from of old. Therefore, any judgment is that we should not trouble those of the Gentiles who turn to God, but should write to them to abstain from the things polluted by idols, and from sexual immorality, and from what has been strangled, and from blood. For from generations Moses had bled in every city those who proclaim him, for he is read every Sabbath in the synagogues.'" Amen. This is the word of God. To start off my sermon with a song that you probably are familiar with. And think to yourself what emotions come to your mind when you listen to this music that you're playing. So small. And do we have sound, Pastor June? Could you make it bigger? Come to mind commit old memories by saying, Pastor Joseph, how can you play that at church? We're not that old. old memories, you know, what comes to mind? I hear this song played now and then at funerals. Not Christian funerals, but, you know, just gentlemen usually, not ladies, but gentlemen, it's like a celebration of life, saying that, you know, this person that lived their life to the full, and they've enjoyed it, and they were successful in their own way, and they lived their way, my way. So it's a, you know, a little bit of meditative and celebratory ring to it, I guess, of closure of somebody's life. When I listen to this music, I think of my army experience in Korea, you know, ironically. I remember the time I had to play in a band like this for some officers while they were drinking and dancing with their wives, I think. And they were having a good time, and they always asked the brass band members to form a band. Sometimes there was a guitar, there was the drums, and, you know, a swing music and slow dance music, right? And you can guess what I play. Anyway, you know, once there was once, there was usually alcohol involved, people were drinking, and there was, you know, dancing along. And then, you know, this song comes up. We play, and I remember one of the ladies, one of the wives of the officer came close to me, and I guess she was in a good mood. She was like lit up. Her face was red. And she came and put something here, poked something in my pocket here. So I couldn't, you know, I was playing, so I couldn't see what it was, but later after it was over, I opened it up. It was a rolled up piece of paper. It was a $10 bill. It was like a tip. I feel good, actually. I almost earned an extra income from that evening. Well, that's how people enjoy themselves in the world. I'm sure you guys don't do that, right? As Christians? Maybe? Anyway, that's how people relax, how they enjoy life. And people, everybody has a way of their living. They're proud of their way of life, how things are turning out. And they try to make the best of what comes to at them in their lives. And some people are very rigid and stubborn and very proud of my life, my way of life, that they would not bend. Sometimes it can be good, sometimes not so good. But I find sometimes Christians doing the same thing. They're proud of their lifestyle. The newfound lifestyle through Christ. They have a fixed worldview. They are rather rigid. If you've lived, aged a little bit, you have experience and wisdom in life, you know, there's not much room for change for some of us. That can be a good thing, and it can be also a dangerous thing. It can be good that you're stable and you are firm in the ways of the Lord. But it can also be dangerous because there might be little room for God to do new things in your life. Are we so stubborn in my way as a Christian so that there's little room for God's way? You know, I want to ask you this question. When you do your tithing, is it before tax or after tax? How do you do it? You don't have to answer, just think about it. I had this discussion with my wife when we were newlyweds. You know, different world, come together, one family. So we had a discussion, and I thought we would. Some people at church think the most valuable function of the church is Bible study. I've been raised up in a well-educated Bible class, all these Bible classes, and you gotta learn Bible study. And that person's heart, their way is so strict. Bible study, Bible study, Bible study, all the way. But if you're not in Bible study, they might judge you inside your heart. Some people say the most important function of the church is evangelism and missions. So if you're not, if the church is not involved in evangelism, you are disobedient to the Lord. This is my way. And they sometimes mistake their way with God's way. We try to align our way with God's way, but sometimes our ways, we think, is the highway, and it's the only way. We get stubborn sometimes. We see a struggle in the book of Acts, in chapter 15, the church struggling with different views, different opinions, saying, this is the best way. This is God's way. No, this is God's way. Want to see how the church resolved this conflict, this bitterness, and that was brewing inside the church? And through this, hopefully, you and I can find not my way, but God's way. My prayer as I prepare this sermon is that you and I would just be in prayer that God, if there's my way, if there's a way that I'm living that does not please you, and I thought it was right, would you give me the humility to lay it down and receive your way? That's been my prayer this morning for you and for me. What is